what work is. We stand in the rain in a long line, waiting at Ford Highland Park for work. You know what work is. If you're old enough to read this, you know what work is, although you may not do it. Forget you. This is about waiting, shifting from one foot to another, feeling the light rain falling like mist into your hair, blurring your vision, until you think you see your own brother ahead of you, maybe 10 places. You rub your glasses with your fingers, and of course, it's someone else's brother, narrower across the shoulders than yours, but with the same sad slouch, the grin that does not hide the stubbornness, the sad refusal to give in to rain, to the hours wasted waiting, to the knowledge that somewhere ahead a man is waiting who will say, "No, we're not hiring today," for any reason he wants. You love your brother. Now suddenly you can hardly stand the love flooding you for your brother, who's not beside you or behind or ahead, because he's home trying to sleep off a miserable night shift at Cadillac so he can get up before noon to study his German. Works 8 hours a night so he can sing Wagner, the opera you hate most, the worst music ever invented. How long has it been since you told him you loved him, held his wide shoulders, opened your eyes wide, and said those words, and maybe kissed his cheek? You've never done something so simple, so obvious. Not because you're too young or too dumb, not because you're jealous or even mean or incapable of crying in the presence of another man. No, just because you don't know what work is. I grew up during World War II and had a victory garden, and I loved to garden, but I was a lousy gardener. My wife, who's rural in her background, is a fabulous gardener, and so this takes place in her garden. Burial rites. Even on a rare morning of rain like this morning, with the low sky hoarding its riches except for a few mock tears, the hard ground accepts nothing. 6 years ago, I buried my mother's ashes beside a young lilac that's now taller than I, and stuck the stub of a rose bush into her dirt, where, like everything else not human, it thrives. The small blossoms never unfurl. Whatever they know, they keep to themselves until a morning rain or a night wind pares the petals down to nothing. Even the neighbor cat, who craps daily on the paths and then hides deep in the jungle of the weeds, refuses to purr. It's right to end up beside the woman who bore me, to shovel into the dirt whatever's left and leave only a name for someone who wants it. Think of it. My name, no longer a portion of me, no longer inflated or bruised, no longer stewing in a rich compost of memory, or the simpler one of bone, kitty litter, the roots of the eucalyptus I planted back in 73. A tiny me, taking nothing, giving nothing, empty and free at last. I should say, since 1958, I've mainly lived in the San Joaquin Valley in the center of California. The Pacheco Pass is what you have to cross to get to Gilroy, Hollister, Santa Cruz, and the ocean. And the San Joaquin Valley is kind of the rural counterpart of Detroit. It's difficult weather, difficult times, factory farming, what have you. Our valley. We don't see the ocean, not ever. But in July and August, when the worst heat seems to rise from the hard clay of this valley, you could be walking through a fig orchard when suddenly the wind cools and for a moment you get a whiff of salt. And in that moment, you can almost believe something is waiting beyond the Pacheco Pass. Something massive, irrational, and so powerful even the mountains that rise east of here have no word for it. You probably think I'm nuts, saying the mountains have no word for ocean. But if you live here, you begin to believe they know everything. They maintain that huge silence we think of as divine, a silence that grows in autumn when snow falls slowly between the pines and the wind dies to less than a whisper, and you can barely catch your breath because you're thrilled and terrified. You have to remember, this isn't your land. It belongs to no one, like the sea you once lived beside and thought was yours. Remember the small boats that bobbed out as the waves rode in, and the men who carved a living from it only to find themselves carved down to nothing? Now you say this is home. So go ahead, worship the mountains as they dissolve in dust. Wait on the wind, catch a scent of salt, call it our life.
Philip Levine, welcome.
Thank you.
What do these photographs make you think about, evoke for you?
A lot. My years in Detroit, my years as an industrial worker, my sense of the arrogance and stupidity of those who ran the city, especially the that industrial empire. I mean, even we who worked there 50 years ago, 60 years ago, could see that this was crashing.
60 years ago, you could see it was crashing?
Oh, yeah. My wife asked me when we came to see this picture here, when we were looking at this picture, she said to me, what did places like that look like when you worked there? I said, they looked like that, or worse.
What is striking is that these years and this experience in Detroit has stayed in your poetry throughout, even in this new volume.
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. It's part of my childhood. It's part of my young manhood. Also, you know, when I was a young guy working in these places and didn't see a way out as yet, and I certainly didn't think the way out would be poetry, even though I was writing it and loved it, I thought then that I'm not going to be the poet I could be because I'm stuck in these lousy places.
You felt that at the time?
Oh, yeah, very strongly. I mean, I felt... And I was, to a degree, I felt somewhat humiliated by the work at that time. I mean, it was so mindless.
What were you doing?
Work in the forge room, usually five people would take an enormous piece of hot steel, which four of us would hold with tongs and put it into a huge press. The fifth guy would push a red button and the press would come down and shape it. Then we would take it out and hang it on a thing and it would go off. What it was, I didn't know.
Really?
No, I didn't know.
So what was poetry then? I mean, where did the poetry come from?
No one knows where poetry comes from. I had been writing poetry from the age of 14. It was just something I loved doing. I loved language. I recognized that I had a facility for it. My teachers praised me to the skies, which was wonderful. My twin brother thought I was a genius. And at the time, that's what I needed. I mean, fortunately, none of those poems survived. But what I needed was someone to say, what you're doing is wonderful, you know. So I kept doing it. Oddly enough, the industrial world was rarely in my poems. Rarely.
Poetry became a way
to live
out.
In another world at the same time that I was living in this world.
Did that become a kind of mission almost, if that's the right word?
Well, one thing I was struck by very young, in my middle 20s, very young, was that I didn't see any work, written work, about this experience. So I actually did at one time say to myself, hey, there's a whole world here no one's touched.
And this should be a subject for poetry.
It should be there. Yeah, it should be there. My attitude toward the work changed enormously over the years. At the time, I hated it. No, but my attitude changed so remarkably when at, say, my late 30s and early 40s, I realized that this world that I thought was going to stop me from writing a poem, writing a decent body of poetry, had in fact become central to my writing poetry. And that revised to a large degree the way I felt about those years. I began to feel that I was really in some ways very fortunate, especially meeting the people that I met.
You're talking about at that time in poetry and in literature, there was not much focus, there was not much written about work, about working class people. What about now?
Oh, much more, much more. The whole arena of poetry has changed remarkably, remarkably. I mean, there's even a whole poetry of say, industrial farming coming out of Chicano writers, right? Now that America's paying attention to black writers, many of whom work in the industrial world, we have their work too. So it's just opened up. Poetry is no longer controlled by some small group of influential people here in New York City. I mean, the university presses are as highly esteemed as any presses. And there's small presses also that are marvelous. They keep the books in print. They sell as many copies as anyone.
And has your writing changed over time?
Oh, yeah, hugely. Hugely. There's much more humor in it, for one thing. Mm-hmm. Much more. I remember when I was about 35, and I published my second book. A friend of mine, I sent it to a friend of mine who was a poet, and he wrote me back. He liked the book, but he said, you know, he lived in Rhode Island, I lived in California. He said, when we used to get together, you were a very humorous guy. You were a very funny guy, and you loved making jokes and et cetera. There isn't any humor in this book.
And you thought to yourself, is he right?
Oh, I knew instantly he was right. And I thought, yeah, at that age, you're buying the image of the desperately serious, focused, slightly mad poet who has no time to make jokes about his life because he's only going to live another 3 weeks, you know, and then jump off the Brooklyn Bridge or something. So, you know, we get suckered into these roles. And I thought, yeah, why don't I bring the humor in? And gradually it has come in more and more.
A lot of your poems tell stories about people from the past and work. There's one even in the current collection, An Extraordinary Morning. Could you read the beginning of that?
Sure. An Extraordinary Morning. Two young men, you just might call them boys, waiting for the Woodward streetcar to get them downtown. Yes, they're tired. They're also dirty and happy. Happy because they've finished a short work week, and if they're not rich, they're as close to rich as they'll ever be in this town. Are they truly brothers? And then the story goes on, and eventually I get you, the reader, sucked into the poem. And so I have three people.
We started out talking about your life in the factories. Many years later, you've made a life as a poet. Does that surprise you?
Yeah, I'm terrifically surprised. One of the things that facilitated it, that's too weak a word. One of the things that made it happen was pure luck. On my 26th birthday, I met my present wife. And how many women could stay with a guy who has no prospects and wants to write poetry and stay with him now 55 years? I mean, I was so incredibly, it could have been another woman. I had already been badly married and behind the eight ball, but suddenly, and I was free now. I didn't owe anybody any money, and I meet this woman, and I fall in love, and she falls in love with me, and she stays with me all these years. Sometimes she works so that I can sit home and scribble, and she honors what I'm doing. And I think that is the most crucial thing, to be honored as a poet. Even if not by a nation, because a nation is an abstraction, but just to be honored by this person or that person, or especially by your wife or your brothers or your mother, father. I mean, it's just fantastic. It keeps you going in a way that nothing else could keep you going.
All right, Philip Levine, nice to talk to you.
Thank you.